unstable angina of the brain. Right? If you have a TIA, there is a 10 to 20% chance you will have a stroke in the next 3 months. But 50% of those strokes happen in the next 48 hours. 10 to 15% of strokes are preceded by TIAs. We need to catch the sentinel event. 30 to 50% of people who have TIAs that last a long time have strokes on diffusion-weighted MRIs. When I started training, we used to call these things rinds. Does anyone remember rinds? This ain't reversible. This ain't benign. It's time for a rebrand. I have a piece of housekeeping. I attended a single ad board by Pfizer and Bristol Myers Squibb, which I don't think will come into talk, but needs to be declared. I want you to meet Joe. Joe saw me last summer on a Saturday in June. It was during the World Cup, and Joe was pissed. And Joe was pissed before he saw me because the Italians were not in the World Cup. And this was a bad day. And during Joe's watching of the game for his beloved Italy not playing, he had a moment. And in that moment, he couldn't talk, and he couldn't move his right side of his body. Joe doesn't go to see doctors. Joe's wife signaled to call 911, and Joe, in his non-dominant hand, in a defiant way, lifted his hand and said, motion to say, you're not calling 911. The friggin' World Cup's on, right? Joe's symptoms resolved in 5 minutes, and he saw me 2 days later when his daughter arrived from out of town to push him to come to a hospital. I want you to think about Joe as we talk about this talk. What I want in this talk is to teach you three things: how to take a history, how to work people up, and how to prevent strokes. Well, with regards to taking a history, the best lecture I've ever been to in my life was by a Harvard-trained stroke specialist who said, I did a 2-year fellowship in stroke, which means I'm much smarter than you. But I'm gonna tell you what I learned in 18 months so that you don't have to waste your time with that stupid fellowship. In 18 months, he told me the most important thing, which is migraines march. When you have a migraine, you feel a little numb here, then a bit later a little numb here, maybe a little bit numb there, but that is not a neurovascular event where things just go boom, like they did to Joe, where you couldn't talk and you couldn't move. Migraines march. And when you have symptoms of a TIA, they are negative symptoms. Unlike positive symptoms, which are cardiac, such as I have chest pain, I feel nauseous, I'm going to vomit, I am sweaty, symptoms of a TIA are negative. I can't move, I can't talk, I can't feel. They're very different, and similar to cardiac, chest pain for a few seconds and stroke symptoms for a few seconds are probably not all that relevant most of the time. You need to realize it is about negative symptoms, it's not about headaches and scotomas. You need to learn to master the eyes. You will see patients with eye complaints in your fast track area. They might even be put into a room that has a slit lamp exam, but their complaint has nothing to do with their eyes. This patient was sent back to me by the ophthalmologist who said, we're sending down a left homonymous hemianopsia who we're seeing in clinic. You might not need to work this person up. If someone has a visual field loss, it is not by default a retinal problem if they are seen in the eye room. You need to do a damn good visual field assessment. And if you recall that ABCD score, which is pretty much useless, they didn't include this sort of stuff. They didn't include visual field, and they certainly didn't include that. Amaurosis fugax is a serious problem. And it's a serious problem that, in the words of famous comedian Rodney Dangerfield, gets absolutely no respect. The eyes need respects. When you look at people who come with retinal TIAs, almost 6,000 people, only a third get head and neck imaging in the next 3 months. 30% get an EKG and less than 10% see a neurologist. We are screwing up the eyes and you need to learn to respect them when you take a history. Now let's look at the pillars of stroke care in Canada, and I want you to think about this, and I want you to think about Joe. There are five things you need to do on every single person who has a TIA. And this was published in CJAM 2 years ago. Of people who had a TIA, 88% got a CT head, 86% got an ECG, 86% received an antithrombotic, 50% received a referral to a neurologist, for which only 36% attended, and 35% got carotid imaging. That last one is abysmal. And I want to talk about this, and I want to talk about how to make change. If you look at number needed to treat in medicine, you almost never see numbers in the threes. If you arrange for someone to have a carotid endarterectomy within 2 weeks of their TIA, their number to treat to prevent a stroke, if you find significant stenosis, it's 3.3. I'm going to say this loud and clear. If you have someone who has a high-risk TIA, and I'm not talking sucky TIAs, and you know what I mean by sucky TIAs, I'm talking you couldn't talk and you couldn't move. That person needs a CT angiogram of their head and neck in the next 24 hours, and I can tell you in my shop, that patient doesn't go home without a CT angiogram now. We don't send home people with chest pain with 95% coronary stenosis. Why the hell are we doing it for patients with carotid stenosis? Change your practice. Get head and neck imaging in your department or shortly after their visit. EKGs. There are two things you need to look for on every EKG on someone who comes in with a TIA or stroke. This is the holy grail. If you see atrial fibrillation on an ECG, and it might be through their family physician who faxed it, it might be through the rhythm strip by EMS, you need to Xerox that, photocopy, and you need to give them a copy of that ECG because you've achieved everything you needed to do. That will forever change their management. Make sure the patient has a copy if it didn't show up in your eMERGE. And lastly, you need to ask every patient with AFib, right before you get to press that fun button when you spark them, just make damn sure that you've asked them if they had a TIA, because there's nothing worse than when you're about to hit that button, someone tells you that yesterday they couldn't feel their arm in their face and move it. And that left atrial clot's not gonna look good at 150 joules when you knock it up. Think backwards, that's what master clinicians do. ECG number one. And ECG number two, I'm going to show you this because I don't crochet and I had to look this up. But crochet or a crochetage sign. A crochetage sign appears near the zenith of the R wave and you see that hook. And that hook is highly specific in patients who are likely to have a paradoxical embolism to having a PFO or an ASD. When you see a stroke that doesn't fit or a TIA, screen them not just for AFib, but for the crochetage sign that occurs in leads 2, 3, and AVF in the inferior leads. 50% plus of the time, it will disappear when you close that defect. Look for this. This is a marker of big shunt and those susceptible to paradoxical embolism. Antiplatelets, things have changed from the, just give them some aspirin, maybe some, you know, other drugs, maybe increase the aspirin. I'm going to sum this up very clear. There have been three key studies, faster, chance, and point. In BMJ this past year, they did a meta-analysis of all the literature, and what they found is that for people with high-risk TIAs or minor strokes, Remember, I'm talking high risk, and they use ABCD scores greater than or equal to 4, but I'm talking real TIAs. People need dual antiplatelet therapy for 21 days. That means 300 Aplavix load, followed by 75 for 3 weeks, and aspirin, maybe a load of 160 to 325, followed by 81 for 3 weeks. That is the time to hit them up with the most important antiplatelet effect. After that effect, the bleeding risk takes over. Remember, if you're going to stroke from your TIA, it's going to happen now. Let's make sure our patients get dual antiplatelet therapy when they leave. Joe came to see me on a Monday. He had his TIA on a Saturday and he examined completely normal. But I have never in my entire life been more convinced that someone had a TIA than Joe. He pretty much read the territory of a left MCA stroke TIA to me, right back at me. So I arranged for a CT, CTA angiogram of his head and neck. And before Joe even came down from the department, the radiologist told me that Joe has a hot clot, and we've spoken to interventional, and he's going right now to have that clot retrieved. Joe left home the next day. Everything was fine. But it's only because we advocate for patients and we got the CT-CTA that needs to change. I want you to think about Joe, because 2 years ago, Joe would have got a CT home and follow up the way I used to practice. I've changed my practice. I want you to think about making the diagnosis of TIAs. I want you to take a story, remember the migraines march, and respect the eyes. I want you to work people up by doing EKGs and doing CT-CTAs, and I want you to put people on dual antiplatelet therapy. Thank you so much for your time.